Welcome to the island of Puerto Rico. Welcome to the island of champions. World champions like Wilfredo Gomez, Felix Trinidad, Yvonne Calderon, and Miguel Cotto. Welcome to Ring City, USA, where rising stars earn their stripes in crossroad fights, with careers on the line and Saturday night main events just a win away.
We are 3,000 miles away from Hollywood's Wild Card Boxing Club, where Ring City USA started last November. Tonight, we come to you live from the island of Puerto Rico, where boxing is more than a sport. It's an integral part of the island's culture, a generational bond forged by more than 60 world champions. This is what the roundabout outside Felix Pagan Pinto's boxing gym in Guantanamo looked like last week. This is what it looks like tonight, as Ring City USA rolls into town for a long-anticipated showdown between 154-pounders Serhii Bohachuk and Brandon Adams. And we welcome you to another installment of Ring City USA. Bob Popo along with two-time world champion Sean Porter. And Sean, this is the first of three cards in the month of March in Puerto Rico. And when you come to this island and you think about the rich tradition, it certainly gets the juices flowing for action, doesn't
Absolutely.
It?
Absolutely. It's a rich tradition, a beautiful island, and we're having a beautiful night so far, and it's going to get even better.
Yeah, and so many times it's like neighborhood fights. We're in a neighborhood for tonight's fights, right here in the little plaza with the circle and the roundabout. Compelling drama, and we've got compelling drama for our main event. This was a fight that was supposed to take place in December in Los Angeles. Serhii Bohachuk, 18-0 with 18 knockouts in his career. Brandon Adams, 22-3. Now, Bohachuk was not able to participate in the fight because he tested positive for COVID-19, but he says he feels great and he's ready to go.
He's blessed. He's made it through with this virus. Says he's 100%. Coach says, hey, he's working hard like always. He's 100%. We're expecting him to come out here tonight. A 100% Serhii Bohachuk is going to fight hard for 10 rounds. Expect him to do that tonight.
But the one thing, a lot of his fights end quickly, is he's going to be going in against a guy that is much more seasoned in Brandon Adams.
Yeah, Brandon, in December, he had his fight against Sonny Duverson, a replacement fight, did exactly what you're supposed to do against a replacement fighter. He knocked out Sonny Duverson in just two rounds. That's what you're supposed to do. But guess what? Tonight, he's got somebody gunning for him, and he's the one who's got to do that and more in order to beat Serhii Bohachuk.
Yeah, and you know what? He's been in against tougher competition over the course of his career. He's fought for a world title, so it'll be interesting to see how this fight goes. And can Bohachuk go the distance? If it has to go the distance, can Adams knock him out quickly? We're going to find out. We're going to start things off, though, with a 10-rounder at 140 pounds. And this is somebody that everybody's excited to see here in Puerto Rico, Danielito Zoria taking on Ruslan Madiev. And Zoria is a young, talented prospect who everybody is pushing their weight behind.
Zoria, he's not Felix Trinidad. However, he's reminiscing of Felix Trinidad. He's got power in both hands, great boxing ability. He's got a great boxing style, and he's exciting, and that's why everyone's excited to see him tonight.
And he's got a very important person behind him here on the island of Puerto Rico. For more on that, let's send it over to Kern Bhatia.
I'm here with legendary fighter Miguel Cotto, six-time champion in four different divisions, and of course calls Puerto Rico home. So Miguel, we know what happened in 2017 with Hurricane Maria, but the island was able to rebuild and prosper and now host events just like this one. What does that say about the island's resilience?
You know, we are a really strong country, and people from here just do their best just to rebuild Puerto Rico and put Puerto Rico back again.
And speaking of trying to do your best, I know your fighter, Danielito Zoria, who is a protege of yours, he used to train alongside you at Wild Card, is fighting tonight. Your team has called him the best prospect in all of Puerto Rico. What do you expect to see from Danielito Zoria tonight?
I just want him to be patient. I just want him to be looking for the best opportunity to finish the match. No, just be smart in the ring.
Daniel Tazaria is next up. Miguel Cotto, enjoy the fights tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Back to you, Bob.
Always great to see the great Miguel Cotto, especially when we're here in Puerto Rico. And we were talking about Danielito Zoria. 25 years of age, goes by the nickname El Zorro. Loves the hat. He says, hey, look, I look sexy in the hat. I'm like a fox. I can adapt. He won 8 national titles here in Puerto Rico, a bronze medalist in the 2013 Pan Am Games. Let's take a look at the protocols as governed by Ring City USA. Everyone tested for COVID-19, the fighters, the handlers, trainers, promotional staff, no fans in attendance, although we're in a neighborhood so people can watch from their backyards. Daily temperature screening, masks must be worn at all times, and obviously social distancing like we're doing up here on our platform. Ruslan Madiev, 28 years of age from Kazakhstan. He's 13-1 with 5 knockouts in his career, but other than his pro debut, all of his fights have been in the United States. Has not fought, though, since July the 13th of 2019 in California when he won an 8-round unanimous decision. Let's take a look at the tail of the tape as we get set for tonight's first bout of the evening between Zoria and Madiev. Zoria, 27 years of age, Madiev, 28 years of age. You see the weigh-in at 139.6 for both. Zoria has rehydrated to 150 pounds, and Madiev 150.4. Time for the formal introductions as we welcome in tonight's ring announcer, Lupe Contreras.
From El Gimnasio Felix Pagan Pintor, Guaynabo City, Puerto Rico, boxing is back on the island. This is Ring City USA, anyone, anytime, anywhere. Presented in association with Bash Boxing, Miguel Cotto Promotions, H2 Entertainment, and Golden Boy Promotions. This is our co-featured bout of the evening, set for 10 rounds. On the line, the vacant WBO NABO Junior Welterweight Championship. Supervisor, El Licenciado Enrique Mendoza. Our judges at ringside are Chris Flores, Steve Weisfeld, and Gerardo Martinez. At the sound of the bell, the man in charge of the ring, referee Gianni Guzman. Presenting first, the fighter standing in the blue corner. He enters the ring wearing gold with black trim. He weighed in at an official 139.5 pounds. He enters the ring in his 15th professional bout, with an outstanding record consisting of 13 victories, 1 lone defeat, 5 of those victories coming by way of KO. Fighting out of Karaganda, Kazakhstan, the madman, Ruslan Madiev. Across the ring in the red corner, wearing black with red and white trim on the scale, he weighed in at an identical 139.5 pounds. Tonight, atop the Ring City USA canvas, he looks to remain undefeated as a pro with a record of 14 victories, 11 of those victories coming by way of KO. Toa Baja Puerto Rico presente, Danielito El Zorro Zorrilla.
Well, like we were in Los Angeles at the Wild Card Boxing Club, outdoors here in Puerto Rico, 77 degrees, humidity at 73%. A little bit of a wind and a little bit of different circumstances, Sean, because where we were worrying about whether boxers were warmed up, these are very comfortable temperatures to be fighting outside.
Comfortable temperatures, but we were worried about some rain. I don't think we're going to get it. And with that being said, the fight has begun.
Zoria with 2 first-round knockouts in his career, 11 knockouts in 14 professional bouts. Madiev has 1 first-round knockout,
but that came in his third pro fight back in 2015.
You see the experience of both of these guys. They're both being patient, and they're both working their styles. Zaria is more of a boxer. He's using the ring, stepping around. Not too much energy being expelled, but you also see Madiev coming forward the way a lot of these European fighters like to do. Hands up, with a strong body. He's going to try to break down Zaria.
Zaria said that Madiev's style, he told us during the fighter meetings, it's a perfect style for me to look great. Welcome in the fourth member of our broadcast team, Brian Campbell. And Brian, obviously, Zoria is the prospect, but Madiev is a guy that he had a lot of amateur experience, and his lone loss was a questionable one.
Look, he went in there against a very credible name in Pablo Cesar Cano. It was a fight in which Madiev was down on the cards early, but made a huge rally, and right when he had Cano hurt, an accidental clash of heads stopped the bout. They went to the scorecards. Madiev took the loss by technical decision. It's a fight that still eats at him, and he said if he can get past Zoro tonight, he's going to be looking for that rematch with Cano.
Yeah, and he was angry with his promotional team because he felt that the team of Cano, because initially he was ruled the winner, and then they went to the instant replay, and they realized it was an accidental clash of heads, but he didn't feel his team did enough to lobby on his behalf.
Well, if you can't beat him, join him. Cano, promoted by Golden Boy Promotions. That is who is backing Madiev right now.
I think Zaria, understanding he's got 10 rounds, I think he's holding back. He's not doing as much as he could do. I like to see faster punches from him. Like we see right here, the more consistent offensive attack right there. I think we saw about five or six punches right there, which is more than he's thrown at one point in time.
Madiev trying to work his jab. Final 10 seconds of the opening round, scheduled for 10 at 140 pounds.
That's what happens when you hear the clap. Guys go for it at the end.
Well, Zaria isn't the only fighter, guys, who has a celebrity connection of boxing royalty with Miguel Cotto. Madiev, from the same hometown as middleweight champion Gennady Golovkin in Kazakhstan, was promoted by Triple G Promotions for most of his pro career. We mentioned, though, that loss to Cano, it led to a falling out between Madiev and Triple G Promotions. He's got a new team behind him and a new trainer in Joel Diaz, who told us he actually advised Madiev not to accept this fight, mostly because of the long layoff coming in, but also he didn't feel his guy could get a decision in an opponent's backyard like this of a highly touted prospect like Zaria. He was overruled, however, by Madiev, who said, I want the fight. I saw Zaria before. I think I can beat him. This is my opportunity to shine.
And Joel Diaz said that Ruslan makes my job very easy. He's disciplined. He's humble. He's respectful. He's very dedicated to his craft.
But
last thing you want to do is, Sean, sometimes you have talented fighters, but you got to chase them down just to get them in the gym.
Yeah, well, you know what? I love Joel Diaz's energy right there in the corner. He only one round in, he's lit the fire already on Madiev, and you see a different approach from his offense this second round.
Good hook to the body inside there by Zaria.
This is the distance Madiev has to operate under to have the optimum success. He goes to the body well, but if you're noticing, he's using more feints than he normally does to try to get inside and get underneath that jab of Zaria.
And you know, that's why we always say styles make fights. Zaria has a style that he can box from the outside and move, turn off of the ropes. However, Madiev's got that pressure style, you see, as he's doing right there, and he's gonna force Zaria to fight his style, which is basically going to sit there and trade,
that'll
work into Madiev's hands.
You saw the scorecard come up. It is always great having as part of our team here at Ring City USA, the Hall of Fame referee handling the judging for us. Double S, Steve Smoger. And he gave the first round to Zuria, one of only 11 referees in the International Boxing Hall of Fame. One of several Hall of Fames that Double S has
been inducted into. One point behind the head, all right?
Mahdiev smiling there, Sean, after eating a stiff right hand from Zuria. That's a punch Zuria likes to do. If you're not going to come in with a jab, he'll catch you with a lead right hand to sort of check your chin on the way in.
Yeah, I like what he did right there. He threw a punch to the body, then he feinted to the body and came up top, and he landed a clean punch right there. But Mahdiev's not going to stop. He's going to try to smother him, stay up on him. And like the fire that Joel Diaz gave him, he's going to use his hands a lot more than he did in the first round.
No point.
Zuria, though, landed a nice, crisp, short combination.
But
Mahdiev trying to work those hooks to the body. Nice jab and then a right hand by Zuria. Part of it was blocked, but not all of it.
It was good timing by him. You know, Mahdiev's moving his head. And Zuria was able to touch him with a 1-2. This is a good second round for both guys.
Right hand to the ear by Zuria scores.
Good overhand right there. Guy that keeps his hands up, tight defense like that. Mahdiev, you have to go around those gloves sometimes.
Okay, break. Bye.
You hear Diaz saying, go, get in.
End of round number two.
So you need to work a little more.
Back in Puerto Rico, Danielito Zuria and Ruslan Mahdiev in between rounds two and three. And Sean, you mentioned the timing of Zuria, and we see it right here.
Yeah, right here. Mahdiev's moving his head, but the timing right there with the 1-2, two basic punches. Very good timing right here by Zuria. And then Mahdiev coming back with the jab. Both those guys made some good adjustments going into that second round. Very interested to see what this third round looks like.
But
round number three underway, scheduled for 10, 140 pounds. Puerto Rico's own Danielito Zuria squaring off against Ruslan Mahdiev.
See up, you see the adjustment. Zuria comes out, jab, 1-2, and he's stepping around. Now he's trying to box more. Mahdiev gets in and he locks him up. The ref breaks him up. Right there is where Joel Diaz wants his fighter Mahdiev to work. Right there on the corner of the ropes.
Zuria spent the first two rounds being more of a counterpuncher, not necessarily making Mahdiev pay for the real estate he was absorbing coming in on him.
Yeah.
You're seeing a slight adjustment here. We're seeing Zuria take the lead a little bit more.
Yeah, you see a small step back and now uppercut. There you go. He's just starting to work at what he does well, which is that boxing from that range and that distance. And again, styles make fights. This is going to be a great fight because you got one guy who needs to get in, wants to get in, and the other guy can't fight on the inside like you see him doing right here, but typically he wants to fight from the outside just like that.
All right, so Sean, let's put you in Mahdiev's corner. What do you want to see him do more of as Steve Smoger has given the first two rounds to Zuria?
To be honest with you, man, I want to see Mahdiev do exactly what he's doing. Take some chances, overhand right, and then he stepped over and threw another right hook. You know, he's got to take some more chances. I think if anything, I'd like to see more of that.
Yeah, Mahdiev's a grinder. This is the style he likes. One thing he has to be careful, though, if you watch a lot of tape on Zuria, is if you get caught in that mid-range, he'll throw combinations in his left hook, reminiscent of the great Felix Trinidad, as Sean said to open the broadcast. That's an out punch. He can remove you from your senses with that beautiful shot.
missed with the left, but fired off the right to Zuria.
I'm going to go on record for saying I disagree with Double S. I gave my Diaz the second round. Two close rounds.
This is a simmering rivalry here at ringside.
Oh!
Good right hand by Mania. I see the Double S in round number two, but it was close.
Right, right. No.
The worst thing Zuria can do that he's doing is pull it straight back with his hands down.
Okay, break.
Adia's throwing wide shots. He's leaping into him, lunging into him, bringing his legs. That's where the power is, where you generate the power. Just like that, he's going to catch him eventually. Leaning straight back.
Taste a little bit of a right hand there as he went straight back.
10 seconds.
There you go.
Break.
Better exit right there was to get low.
Those seconds of round number three. Danielito Zuria, promoted by Miguel Cotto Promotions, and he told us that is a big honor.
Mi comienzo siempre me llamó la atención mi Miguel Cotto y Tito Trinidad. Lo que ellos causaban en el público en Puerto Rico, pues fue algo que me motivó al yo algún día estar en esos zapatos. Claro está, Miguel Cotto es Miguel Cotto. Tito Trinidad es Tito Trinidad. Yo soy Danielito el Zorro y voy a llenar mis propios zapatos. Se nota que el trabajo que se está haciendo en el gimnasio con mi equipo de trabajo, pues está dando el fruto que tiene que dar. Y gracias a ese fruto, pues me están nombrando como el próximo campeón mundial que va a ser así.
There is Miguel Cotto to the left and Ivan Calderon to the right. Two great champions from Puerto Rico, and Cotto with a close look at Danielito Zuria.
Another bling bling right there on Calderon.
You can't see it with the mask on, but Iron Boy still has that baby face after all these years.
He does.
Can Matiev make Zuria pay when he has him in this spot?
Keep him up.
How much, Sean, are you thinking Zuria setting traps, almost letting Matiev advance a little bit further into the corner, hoping maybe to set him up with that left hook?
I can see it. You know, you can see that Zuria's comfortable there. When you see a guy getting punches are being thrown at him, but you see he's comfortable, he's calculating, and he's trying to find those moments. Right there, just allowing him to walk into a body shot and then get back on the move. Not too much, but not too little.
But the one thing, Sean, that you illustrated before, if he's setting that trap, he cannot make the mistake of going straight back.
And you know what? I saw the adjustment last round where I said, don't pull straight back, don't lean straight back. And then you saw his exit strategy became getting down low. And that's because he calculated that my DF throws a lot of overhands and a lot of hooks.
Get to work, let's go. 1, 2, work in there.
Break.
Tell you what, though, if you're Matiev's team, you have to like when he's able to get that pressure in the corner and first force the break. Even if he's not landing clean, it tells the judges something, that you're the aggressor, you're the ring general, making your opponent fight on your terms.
Yeah. I mean, he's taking some shots. He's giving some. I think he's taking more than he's giving, but he still is being aggressive. And he's kind of forcing Zuria to fight his fight. I got a feeling that Zuria's he's doing this because he wants to. I think he wants to try to counter him really fast and then, like, right there, lock him up so that he can't use his offense. See that? A lot of people, a lot of coaches, they don't teach their fighters to leave their feet. However, when you have a fighter that can generate power like that from kind of springing up, and it works, you're able to get to a guy who's longer than you because you got that spring in your step.
Nice combination there by Zuria.
Yeah.
Break. Listen.
When Mariev has Zaria where he wants him, Sean, is he creating enough angles, though, where he can deliver meaningful blows?
Zaria, is he creating enough angles?
No, Mariev. When he gets him in tight.
You know, it's far and few in between. I mean, he's getting one big shot to Zaria's two or three. Now, another good round right there, the fourth round. You got a good right hand. Oh, great overhand right. I guarantee you more of that when we get back.
Danielito Zoria of Puerto Rico, one of the promising young prospects and one of the greatest of all time from Puerto Rico, Miguel Cotto. And we have a little poll going on at Ring City USA. Who's the greatest Puerto Rican fighter of all time? We can only fit four on there. Miguel Cotto, Felix Trinidad, Wilfredo Gomez, Hector Camacho. We don't have Calderon on there. We don't have Wilfredo Benitez on there, just to name a few. Round number four begins.
Break.
No knockdown so far in the fight. John, I guess the question I was trying to ask you, when Mariev has Zoria pinned against the ropes, is he too square to him as you see Steve's Ogre scorecard?
Uh-huh. Well, Steve got it.
3-1. He gave the last round to Mariev.
Yeah, I got 3-1. Right here. I mean, he's just got to keep working. I have seen some punches behind the head that I don't like from my DF, but, you know, when you're a fighter who's got to work and break down another fighter, you're going to throw wherever the opening is. I think the best thing he can do, which I'm not sure he's been trained to do, is when you get a guy backing up like this, take a small step to the right or to the left, and that'll create a different angle. And possibly another opening that hasn't been there previously. You know, he's playing the same tune. Right there's a great hook. But I think that Zaria's picking up on the music and he's able to adjust.
One thing Joel Diaz talked about in mentioning that he didn't want Mariev to accept this fight. Once Mariev fought through that detour, he basically told his fighter, you're going to have to be dominant to get this scorecard, to get the judges a sway in a fight in your opponent's hometown. You're going to have to knock this guy out, if not knock him down a few times.
Let's check in with Kern. Kern?
In the blue corner, this is only the second fight with Mariev and Joel Diaz. Between rounds, Joel Diaz shook Mariev's head and said, wake up. He said he wants to see more combination punching, more pressure, and the biggest thing, in clinches, he wants him to let go of Zaria. He feels like Zaria is taking advantage in the clinches, and he wants him to move back. Back to you guys.
Zaria's taking some chances here. He's starting to throw wide and stand there and exchange with Mariev. Not a good move for Zaria. Get off of the ropes, turn, or lock him up like you've been doing, and cause the ref to step in here and break this up. This is not the fight that Zaria can afford, especially not in the fifth round.
I don't think he's showing enough respect for Mariev's forward pressure and power here.
And I want to go back to what you said. He said, Joel said, hey, in order for you to win this fight, you've got to break this guy down and beat him down. He's not winning rounds, but he's breaking down Zaria. Trust me, Zaria's mouth is open now. He's laying on the ropes a lot longer than we've seen in previous rounds. And
big
another
right
big
hand.
Right hand.
Oh, yeah, that was a good right hand by Mariev.
I'm telling you, it could be coming. When you came down here, you knew I'm in this guy's backyard. I got to beat him down. I said that in the fight of me. I said he's going to beat down. And that's what he's doing right now. He's going after Zaria, and he's not going to stop.
1 point. 1 point.
That was coming. That was coming.
That's going to be key.
It is.
One goes the distance.
It is. All right. But I mean, let's take a look at the landscape here, man. This Mejia's not gonna stop.
So a very good round for Mariev, but he has a point deducted.
happened in this last round. Madiev was winning the round. Big, big overhand right there he landed, but then right there he got greedy. You gotta know when to stop punching, especially in moments like that. But right here, big overhand right. He was winning the round. Wasn't just that overhand right that won him the round, but then he had points taken from hitting behind the head.
That is a potential momentum killer when you get that taken away from you.
That too, but I think he saw enough success that's going to push him to keep going forward. Like, you see that? He came right out at Zaria.
I think Madiev's mindset, kind of like his trainer's mindset, is we're not getting out of here with the decision. We got to break him down, and we're going to have to stop him.
I'm telling you, Joel Diaz is an asset to any fighter. He's a smart fighter. He knows how to prepare fighters for war. And they knew coming down here it was going to be a war. This type of fighting style can beat Zaria. He's wrapped up in the ropes.
You're going to sign with your head. Watch your head. Come on. Bye.
Okay, so if you're in the Zaria camp, what would you be advising him, Sean?
I'll be honest with you. I tell him, just keep going. Be mindful of what you're doing. I don't know if that can all be translated to him, but you know, there's some rough things that are happening. Rough is good for my idea, but too much roughness could cause him some technical problems.
You know, Zaria's still not making Madiev pay for cornering him, for getting inside on him. The jab he's been using as a pawing rangefinder, but not a weapon, and that's becoming a key here. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, when you're another big right hand right there and a hook. Zaria felt it. He said, I got to come back. Nice combination by Zaria.
Keep him up. Okay, break.
It's interesting, although Zaria is winning the fight, I kind of feel Madiev imposing his will more.
Madiev is 100% imposing his will. Zaria comes out fresh, but then he gets attacked. And it's the same attack it's been since the very first round. You got a guy who's tedious like that, and he's on you. He's going to break you down physically and mentally. Look at his legs. Big right hand right there by my dear. Look at Zaria's legs. His legs aren't the same. He's not moving the same or punching the same. Big overhand.
Right hand.
Big overhand right.
No, I
want to yell two things. Zaria, don't pull straight back. My DF, keep going.
Watch your head.
This is a great fight, and both guys are doing what they have to do to win this fight.
10 seconds.
Final seconds of round number six between Danielito Zaria and Ruslan Madiev. Scheduled for 10.
Big round right there. Here it is right here. Big right hand. Look, it froze him. He froze. And then he said, no, I got to come back. That's the heart right there. That's what we love. That's why we love boxing. You see everything. You see heart, determination, the physicality of the sport right there. And then a fighter not willing to stop.
As you can see, we are not at the house that Freddie built, the great wild card gym in Hollywood. This is the house that Felix Pagan Pintor built. This gym, renowned just as the legendary names in Puerto Rican boxing are. We've talked about Miguel Cotto, we've talked about Ivan Calderon. Pintor was one of the guys who made champions. Wilfredo Gomez, Iron Boy Calderon, as famous a trainer as it gets on this island, which is so passionate about the sport.
That's beautiful, man. I mean, it's just Puerto Rico is different when it comes to boxing, man. They got it down here. We love it. That's why we're here.
Round number seven underway. Scheduled for 10.
Soltalo.
Steve Smoger's scorecard.
Soltalo. Muy bien.
He's got Zoria in front.
Did he just give? He gave Madiev. I didn't see. That something looked weird there. Big hook right there. Sorry, I'm thinking out loud.
Watch your head. Vamos.
Remember, in round number five, Madiev had a point deducted.
That was the 10-8 that I saw.
Watch your head.
This does play into what Joel Diaz was talking about. Can you do enough if you're Madiev? It is not enough to just get inside. He's going to have to continue to land those looping shots if he's going to get the judge's decision. Or like you said, Sean, maybe it's not about that. Maybe it's about taking this guy's will.
Yeah, you beat him down and break him down. I see Zaria. You see him right now, he's fresh, but we're less than halfway through the round. As this round ticks on, you will see Zaria slow down, and it's because Madiev has taken a lot from him from the start of this fight.
Okay, break. Vamos, no agarremos. Vamos agarrando mucho. Vamos. Vamos. No lo baje, no lo baje.
See that? Zaria's got to be smart. He's trying to lock him up.
He went straight back again,
went
Sean.
Straight back.
Another looping shot.
Yeah.
Good double left hand with the hook to the body to finish it off for Zaria.
Zaria clearly believes in his power. That's why he's sort of still content to wait for Madiev to come to him, but I'm not sure it's enough. You never know when the judges are going to leave. I'm not seeing any boxing, any jabbing from Zaria. Yeah. It's really a switch of a stance set up for a big hook, and if it doesn't land, he's not landing much.
Big hook right there by Madiev.
Hold it.
Here's where Madiev cannot allow Zaria to tie him up. Got to keep his hands free.
The adjustment now is, hey, you put pressure on this kid. He feels the pressure. When you get him against the ropes in the corners, take a little small step back and let your hands go. He'll be right there for everything you want to give him. Zaria's gotten used to the rhythm of, he's going to be on me. Now get off of him and let your hands go. Good body shot. And then bring it right up top.
10 seconds.
Final seconds of round number seven. Round seven in the books. Felix Pagan Pintor and the great Miguel Cotto ringside as Danielito Zaria and Ruslan Madiev battle heading to round eight. Championship. Rory McIlroy and the PGA Tour's best visit, TPC Sawgrass, who will have this year's defining moment, March 13th and 14th on NBC and the NBC golf team in Orlando this week for the Arnold Palmer Invitational. And speaking of Rory McIlroy, he shares the first round lead with Corey Connors at 6 under at Arnold Palmer's Bay Hill. As we begin round number eight. Scheduled for 10. No knockdowns in the fight. Madiev had a point deducted in round number five, a round that he won, at least in our opinion, for hitting behind the head of Zaria.
He was winning that round. I'm not an official judge, so I did something really quirky with that round that nobody will appreciate me for, but it is what it is. I think that Zaria is still ahead on the scorecards because of the early rounds, but Madiev, and because of that round, his point was taken. Fight getting close.
Watch your head.
Each hook that he throws is getting close.
Watch your head. Okay, break. Listen, watch your head.
Serhii, a well-rounded human even beyond boxing. He's got a degree in banking. He also has a part-time small business, a barber shop out of his house. It's about time to bring the close shave to Madiev with that very thick beard in his chest, round after round.
Break. He's going to get another point deducted.
Roll him into corner. Time. Listen. It's not intentional, but it's a legal punch. Punch behind the head. You understand? Okay. Tiene 5 minutos. Oíste.
Fight like men.
Right here. Let's see it. You can't get greedy. You cannot get greedy. You cannot go to someone's backyard and step over the line.
So Serhii will be given time to recover.
Listen.
Now, Yanni Guzman has yet to deduct a point here. In the 5th round, here's where a point was deducted.
At this point, there were a half a dozen punches that were illegally thrown to the back of the head. They were not on purpose. He's not, I'm going to hit you in the back of the head. That's not in his mind. In his mind is, I got to get him. And that type of mindset can get you in trouble from time to time. And it's really gotten my dear, in some trouble
but
now.
But sometimes it can depend on the referee. Each referee almost has their own strike zone.
Yeah. And listen, because I know a lot of people are at home right now and they may be thinking, oh, he can continue. It wasn't that bad, so on and so forth. You always have to be sensitive to the nature of this game. One too many of those, and there's been quite a few, more than a half of a dozen, which is more than 6. There's been quite a few, and now you have to understand that fighter could be at risk.
Por eso le voy a los 5 minutos. Tú me dices, Danielito.
I remember when I was young, anytime in the amateurs, anytime you saw a guy go down, it was, get up, yeah, get up, you know, but now the game is different. You're a professional, and you have a future beyond boxing.
Well,
situations like this, we always have to consider that.
Serhii has time, like a low blow, 5 minutes. But he is certainly not reacting like somebody that is going to shake this off.
All right?
Look, rabbit punch is obviously illegal for a very major reason, the danger of getting hit in the back of the head. And already a very dangerous sport. And Sean, of course, you remember the Pritchard Cologne fight a few years back against Terrell Williams that had the very heartbreaking ending there. There were low blows, there were rabbit punches in between in a very close fight. You really hope for the best for Serhii right now as he takes the time to figure out if he's going to be able to continue.
Absolutely. And Pritchard Cologne being a Puerto Rican himself, you know, that was devastating. I still keep up with that family. And they're still going through it, you know. So we just have to be sensitive to this situation and get rid of the macho mindset that a lot of fighters and a lot of people have. You know, me being a fighter, I say right now the decision is on Serhii whether or not he wants to continue. And if he says, I'm not going to continue the fight, he's taken enough punches to the back of the head that the fight now has been stopped and you go to the scorecards. The worst is that you do disqualify Madiev.
Madiev is motioning to his corner that he didn't hit him behind the head, that he hit him more to the side of the head.
And it's just like football. Like right now, we see a lot of hard hits in football, and you'll see a guy, you say he came in with the front of his, no, he didn't, but at the last minute, that player moved and made an adjustment. And now it's an illegal shot. And the same thing with boxing. The last minute, Serhii maybe, you know, turning his head or pivoting a little, anything like that. And now the punch has gone from, the trajectory of the punch has gone from the side of the head to now the back of the head. This is unfortunate because it was a good fight. It was becoming close. And I felt it was interesting from beginning to this point of it being stopped. There you go. Too legit to quit.
It's 90s DJ after my heart here with a little hammer.
Hey. He's after your heart, huh?
Well, clearly, Zaria was hurt by that shot in the back of the head because kind of went down to his knees, and given his the time he needed to recover, it almost looked like he started to feel the effects even worse. So the fight stopped in round number 8. We'll have the decision when we return. Back in Puerto Rico, Ring City, USA, the first of 3 cards in Puerto Rico in the month of March. And you see Danielito Zoria sitting in the corner of the ring, got hit in the back of the head. And in round number 5, referee Yanni Guzman deducted a point from Ruslan Madiev for that punch right there in the back of the head. That was a round that we thought Madiev was winning, and then round number 8 happened again. Again, Madia was kind of boring his way in, hit Zoria in the back of the head. Zoria went down, and ringside physician came to look at him, and they gave him as much time as he wanted and could not continue. Let's set it up to the ring, and Lupe Contreras.
Ladies and gentlemen, at 1:16 of round 8, referee Yanni Guzman calls a halt to this contest due to an accidental foul. And in accordance with the rules of the World Boxing Organization, we go to the scorecard to determine a winner. Judge Flores scores it 77-75 in favor of Zoria. Judge Weisfeld scores it 76-73 in favor of Madiev.
Oh, wow.
And Judge Martinez scores about 77-74. In favor of the winner by way of technical decision. And now, WBO NABO champion from Puerto Rico, La Zorra Zoria.
That was a good fight. You cannot boo the decision. Early rounds. Early rounds won by Zaria, and also a point taken away from Madiev from hitting in the back of the head. And then now here, the fight stopped because of a punch in the back of the head.
Madiev stormed out of the ring, and you see Zaria still suffering the effects of that punch in the back of the head. But he is the winner by technical decision in round number 8. And Madiev suffers the second loss of his career. But there were a lot of things that he could build upon with the way that fight was starting to unfold. The win goes to Zoria. Madiev leaves Puerto Rico angry. But coming up next, I got Carlos Zambrano squaring off against Brian Chevalier here on Ring City USA.
This is Curran. Okay. Yes, got it.
The Dunder Mifflin family has found a new home. The Office is streaming now exclusively on Peacock. Whether you know every quote or you're a newbie to Scranton, you can stream every episode again and again. Sign up at peacocktv.com to stream now. Gorgeous views here in Puerto Rico for the first of three telecasts from Puerto Rico. And Danielito Zoria, who wins an eight-round technical decision, got hit in the back of the head, could not continue in round number eight. They went to the judges' scorecards. He won on two of the three scorecards to win the fight and remain undefeated. He is now 15-0, but he is still suffering the effects of that hit in the back of the neck. And the medical staff will make sure they take all precautions and make sure that
he says
Zoria is okay, but
I need my hat.
El Zorro.
A
little
he's
flair
all right
for the dramatic. Well, obviously, he is a young and talented prospect from the island of Puerto Rico with his rich boxing tradition. For more on that, let's send it over to Curran.
Thanks, Bob. The story of our venue revolves around this island, which is very passionate about the sport of boxing. They love fighting here. And two men are very important to that story. One of those is Felix Pagan Pintor. His face is on the mural behind us. He is a decorated trainer who worked with over 60 world champions. And also Ivan Calderon, who is a two-time former champion. But Ivan has reinvented himself as a trainer and a mentor for the youth in this island.
No, this is like my house. And now it's my opportunity to grow boxes to be a world champion like I was.
You had a lot of success in your career. You were a two-time world champion. You had 18 successful defenses. What did you enjoy more, being an active fighter or now what you're able to do in terms of teaching the youth of Puerto Rico?
Both. I enjoy giving Puerto Rican a lot of growth and being two-time world champion and teaching kids how to box and showing them that it's not easy like they think. You want to be a world champion? Discipline. That's the main event of this. A discipline and hungry to be a world champion. That's it.
The Puerto Rican government allocates a significant amount of money towards youth boxing. This is rare. This doesn't happen anywhere else in the U.S. They've created this facility, the Felix Pagan Pintor Community Boxing Center, to help develop talent here, right?
Boxing is another different sport for us. We got like 60-something world champions, so we be doing a lot to be in a small country.
Puerto Rican fighters are known for their resilience, their pride, in a way that embodies what Puerto Rico has gone through with Hurricane Maria.
The day of the Hurricane Maria, the next day everybody got out of their houses and started breaking trees, helping to open the street so we could go through. Each of us started helping each other. We make everything more quicker for Puerto Rico to be back up. And 1 year and a half, we was already back up.
Yvonne, we're here at the Felix Pagan Pintor Community Center. What does that mean to you, that where you're spending your time training young fighters is now going to be the home of Ring City?
Ring City come to Puerto Rico, giving a lot of boxers of Puerto Rico opportunity to let them see the talent. And maybe you never know, Ring City could have a world champion Puerto Rican guy.
Yvonne Calderon, Iron Boy, one of the great boxers from Puerto Rico, from right here in Guaynabo, Puerto Rico, 35-3-1, two-time division world champion, 11 successful defenses of his WBO title, and an Olympian as well. And what a great personality, and he has welcomed us all here at Ring City USA, along with Miguel Cotto, Brian Perez of Cotto Promotions. And once Zorillo is out of the ring, the protocols are in place. Takes about 5 to 7 minutes to sanitize the ring. First they'll spray, and then they'll have others come and wipe down the ring ropes and make sure that everything is in order before the next bout will step into the ring. Carlos Zambrano, Mina, 36 years of age from Peru. He's coming up next here in Ring City, USA, from Puerto Rico. So happy to be in Puerto Rico for Ring City USA, this vibrant island with so much rich tradition in the sport of boxing and the fort in Old Town. We are here three times in the month of March. We'll be back in 2 weeks and then the final week of March as well for Ring City USA. I'm looking forward to our main event between Serhii Bohachuk and Brandon Adams, but we have a 128-pound bout for you. Let's get scheduled for 8 rounds, and let's welcome him once again as he heads into that clean ring, Lupe Contreras.
Ladies and gentlemen, now entering the ring, fighting out of the blue corner, Carlos Zambrano.
Carlos Zambrano, 36 years of age, has not fought since April the 29th, 2017. And Brian, he talked about kind of what motivated him to get back in the ring.
Look, he's a former WBA interim featherweight champion, has not fought since losing that title. We remember him pounding the canvas in disgust and crying after that loss. It kept him out. He got his heart broken from the sport, but it was the nudging of his family in recent years to get in his ear and tell him he still got some left in the tank. This is what he does. It's his passion. He finally started to listen to them during the quarantine, and about 6 months ago, really got serious again. He said he never fell out of shape throughout the entire time out, as he teaches kids how to box. He mentors, he's a public speaker. Now he's back on his own terms following some promotional issues to try to restart his career.
And the grandson of Peruvian great Mauro Mina, who had 52 wins as a pro.
Across the ring in the red corner, Brian Chevalier.
Brian Chevalier, 26 years of age, from Bayamon, Puerto Rico. 14-1-1, he's got 11 knockouts. Has not fought, though, in 453 days. His last fight, December the 7th, 2019. See what Chevalier can do against the veteran Zambrano coming off his long layoff. Let's take a look at the tail of the tape for our next bout of the evening, scheduled for 8 rounds at 128 pounds. Chevalier, 26 years of age, as mentioned. Zambrano, 36 years of age. The height advantage for Chevalier, reach advantage though for Zambrano. Now for the formal introductions, back to Lupe.
We continue with the action here at the Gimnasio Félix Pagan Pintor, Guaynabo, Puerto Rico. This is Ring City USA, presented in association with Bash Boxing, Miguel Cotto Promotions, and H2 Entertainment. This bout, set for 8 rounds in the super featherweight division. Our judges at ringside are Ramon Solis, Luis Ruiz, and Gerardo Martinez. Our referee, Ramon Peña. Presenting first, the fighter standing in the blue corner, wearing silver with red and blue trim on the scale. He weighed in at an official 127 pounds. In 27 pro bouts, he maintains an outstanding record of 26 victories. One lone defeat, 11 of those victories coming by way of KO. The former WBA interim featherweight champion of the world, representing Chincha, Peru, Carlos Mina Zambrano. Across the ring in the red corner, wearing white with silver and blue trim, his official weight, 127.5 pounds. In 16 pro bouts, he too maintains an impressive record consisting of 14 victories, one defeat, one draw, 11 of those victories coming by way of KO. Representando a Bayamón, Puerto Rico, Brian Chari Chevalier.
Carlos, ¿y está con principal? Ok, muchachos, ustedes son dos profesionales, ya reciben las instrucciones en sus esquinas. Recuerden protegerte en todo momento y respetar mis comandos. Choquemos guantes y Dios los bendiga.
I like that. I saw a smile and I saw a scowl. I dig it.
Ready, doctor.
Well, two guys coming off some very lengthy layoffs for Chevalier. 453 days. Zambrano, almost 4 years.
Chevalier is itching to get back. He was scraping the canvas with his feet almost like a bull ready to charge here, and you certainly saw the intensity of that stare down.
And you saw, and you see Zabrano, he's been wanting to get back in the ring. He says, I've been here before. It's nothing different for me. You can see it by that smile in the middle of the ring.
Chevalier said he never left the gym. He said because of where he's ranked, number 8 by the WBO, he had problems getting fights, then the pandemic hit.
Chevalier certainly has a size advantage here, but the experience advantage overwhelmingly goes to Zambrano, and it's going to be interesting coming off such a long layoff, almost 4 years, whether Zambrano can pick up where he left off and stay sharp.
I gotta be honest, I love his story, Zambrano, so it's a piece of me rooting for him.
Well, his title loss to Claudio Marrero in 2017, which was a first round knockout. He accepted that fight on just 15 days notice. Had some issues with Mayweather Promotions that led to a breakup in their relationship. And even before that, he had a 2-year layoff. So this is a guy who has been anything but active, but so far, he looks ready to go, Sean. Once it's India, it's like riding a bike, let's be honest.
for some of us, it's like riding a bike. It's a little tougher for other guys. Good move right there to get behind Zabrano. Was Chevalier, and he did the right thing right there. This is going to be a technical and very tactical fight. You can see it already. Both guys are very fundamentally sound. They're not going to waste energy, waste punches, keeping their hands up, and taking what they can get. Chevalier right there just jabs.
Right, TBR. Hey.
Watching the back of the head now.
Box.
Referee Ramon Pena giving a little caution there to,
you know what happened after the, what happened in the last fight. After what happened in the last fight.
Well, that's a knockdown.
And I thought that was a punch in the back of the head.
Yeah.
Because an arm was being held.
Yeah. Nullifies what I was going to say, because I was going to say all of these referees now are on edge about that punch, but he was hit in the back of the head.
Beautiful left uppercut there from Chevalier, catching him coming forward.
This kid, Chevalier, he sounds heavy-handed.
Oh, he's a puncher. What I like about him is you see the height, 5'11". He's tall for this division, but he doesn't give up his height, yet still is a very aggressive fighter who comes in there looking to get you out of there.
See, he's...
good right hand to the body, and then Zambrano with a left late. You see the arm was being held right here, and it looks like this punch went to the back of the head. It did, but it was ruled a knockdown. Take a look at the punch that was ruled a knockdown, and if that's not in the back of the head and neck, Sean, I don't know what is.
We don't see the referee until the very end, and I know a lot of us are saying, oh, that's a punch to the back of the head, but from where the ref was standing, he couldn't see the punch. Only thing he saw was Zabrano hit the ground, hit the canvas, and that's why he called it a knockdown.
Round number 2 scheduled for 8 underway.
Good exchange of jabs right there.
It was a good first round, though, for Chevalier regardless.
Yeah, I agree. He won that round regardless of the knockdown.
There's a cut along the right eye.
On Chevalier, the corner worked on it between rounds. It looked to come on that left hook that Zambrano hit right at or after the bell to end round 1.
but not an accidental clash of heads.
Oh, there's another one.
No, me pegaron la cabeza, primera advertencia, okay? Vamos allá. Box.
A little bit of bad luck there for Zambrano as he got spun around, but that's dangerous. We've seen it now time and again.
And now Zambrano's, you see a little different energy now from Zambrano. He's like, I got to take it to this kid. Exchange of hooks right there, too. Zambrano, he's got to calm down.
Break.
Yes, you've got tons of experience, but it's been 4 years. You got to calm down and start to work what you used to work. Work your style. Don't go for it all. Don't let the moment get the best of you.
Here's the problem, though, Sean. This is an 8-round bout. Zambrano down in round one, already down on the cards, while it's more strategic for him to box. He's got to do something to try to get back into this fight. The problem is you do not want to hook with a hooker. And we know that that Chevalier has a beautiful left hook.
And even right there, Zambrano throws an overhand right, and Chevalier comes in front of his overhand and throws a hook and catches him. Good timing by Chevalier, and just good boxing ability by Chevalier as well. I like Zambrano. He's got to loosen up. I think he's too tight right now. I think he's taking shots. Use better defense like that right there. Dip down into the shots and loosen up. He's tight.
He's almost on tilt, as they say in the poker game.
Oh,
you don't know nothing about that, though, Sean. All right, come on.
You know, my head went to a game that I used to play where there were cartoons playing poker. You knew the guy who was on tilt was very hot and mad. And that's the way Zambrano's performing right now.
Well, the other thing too, Sean, is, as Brian pointed out, there's a right hand over the top. But when you have one fight in 6 years,
yes.
How sharp can you actually be?
Yeah, it's tough when you know you have had such a leg.
Take one more look at Chevalier with a punch to the back of the head of Zambrano. Got spun around and. There you go.
Welcome back to Ring City USA from Puerto Rico. In our last fight, Danielito Zuria was hit illegally in round 5, a point taken off, eventually hit in the back of the head in round 8. He was taken away on a wheelchair, put into an ambulance, and sent to the hospital for observation. On his way out, I asked him, are you okay? He was able to verbally say he's okay, but his body language did not look good. I'll update you guys as I know more.
Good report there from Curran on Zuria.
The markings above the right eye of Chevalier starting to drip a little bit of blood. The corner worked on it aggressively between rounds. You can still see a hunk of that stuff, Sean. That stuff they put on it, dripping off of his face.
Why you call it stuff?
You're a little closer to the action. Can you fill in the blanks?
What I know, it's Vaseline.
Some say tomato. Come on, Sean.
All right. Well, that stuff is going to, you know, stay there, and they're going to try to protect it. Good jab there by Zambrano. He's just walking straight in. I like, and then he's teeing off. Don't tee off. Now, every punch, you can't be teeing off and loading up on every punch. Some straight punches down the pipe will work for Zambrano. He's just got to try it.
Chevalier puts his hands together with a 3-punch combination. There's that right from Zambrano again.
Chevalier's, he's a very physical fighter too. He's not fighting on the inside, but he knows how to work his way through the clinches and he knows how to rough up Zebrano, and then he lands a great right hand from the outside right there.
Oh, good left to the body, and then a left to the head sends Zebrano down.
Tres, cuatro, cinco, seis, siete.
The left hook to the body started it. That, unlike the first round, was a real knockdown.
Can he survive? The first time he got knocked out, he just got put out. He's got to survive right here. He's got to dig deep.
Oh! Blistering shot to the midsection sends Zebrano down again.
He's going to have no business getting up from that one. That's the real deal right there.
He's not getting up.
Nueve, diez.
Boom. Wow.
Yes, sir.
Brian Chevalier.
This is a fighter to watch.
Yeah. I was unaware.
He's big. He fights big. He's a little bit cocky. We love the stare down, the intensity in the beginning. And oh, as we mentioned throughout this fight, has an out punch, a real money shot there with that left hook. Beautiful performance.
He's thumping in there, isn't he? You can hear it. And right there, great body shot.
Let's take a look at the first knockdown in round number three. And it was a hook to the body and then a left hook to the head, Sean.
Boom, boom. Yes, sir. He got his attention with the body shot, and then he came right up to the head. And it just put him off balance. This is beautiful boxing right here. Look, boom. Both sides, and then, great body shot. Great body work.
Yeah, there was a right to the body, and then the left placed perfectly.
And he's turning with them, too. He was throwing right hooks, and as Zebrano was moving that way, he was turning with him and then walked him into the hook to the body, the left hook to the body.
Well, the corner of Brian Chevalier was pretty impressed with that. We'll get the official time of the stoppage, but Chevalier gets his 12th stoppage in his 17th pro fight here in Puerto Rico, with the main event still to come.
Vamos, vamos, vamos.
PGA Tour's spring swing continues in Florida, the Arnold Palmer Invitational. Corey Connors, Rory McIlroy share the lead after the opening round with Bryson DeChambeau just a shot back Saturday, 2:30 on NBC from Arnie's Place, Bay Hill. Brandon Adams will be fighting in our main event tonight. Adams 22-3 with 14 knockouts. We saw him in December on Ring City USA. Take care of Sonny Duverson. He was supposed to fight Serhii Bohachuk, but Bohachuk tested positive for COVID-19, but Serhii is set and fit and ready to go, and he's gonna get tested tonight. Bohachuk 18-0 with 18 knockouts in his career. Back outside here in Puerto Rico for Ring City USA with the ring on a roundabout on a city street. For the official time of the stoppage, here's Lupe Contreras.
Here at Gimnasio Félix Pagán Pintor, referee Ramon Peña completes the count of 10 with an official time of 2 minutes 21 seconds of round number 3. Your winner, by way of KO, Brian El Chari Chevalier.
2:21 of round number 3. Brian Chevalier with an impressive performance in taking out Carlos Zambrano. A blistering left hand to the body finished him off after a double left combination with a hook and a shot to the head dropped Zambrano earlier in the round. And for the 36-year-old Zambrano, his second career loss. He's coming off almost a 4-year layoff. And let's take a look at some of the highlights, Sean, from that fight. And there's an interesting fight because Chevalier coming off a long layoff in his own right. Now, this was ruled a knockdown in round 1, although we believe it was a hit to the back of the head. But these are real knockdowns in round 3.
Yeah, real knockdowns. It's been too long. Had been too long for Zambrano. Right there's a beautiful body shot. He couldn't avoid this one. Great body shot. Great work through the fight by Chevalier.
And remember, earlier in the round, it was a hook to the body and then a hook to the head in rapid succession that dropped Zambrano the first time. So Brian Chevalier improves to 15-1. With 12 stoppages on his resume as we send it up to Kern.
I'm here with the winner, Brian Chevalier. Brian, we knew that you had the youth advantage, you had the height advantage, and in that third round, you were able to find the body shots. What was your key to victory tonight?
Brian, sabíamos que tenías la ventaja en edad, en estatura. ¿Cómo fue la forma que encontraste la victoria esta noche?
Mira, yo tenía la edad y la estatura, pero él tenía la experiencia. Tenía que bregar con eso. Como dije anteriormente, a lo que él venía, yo me tenía que acoplar a eso y salimos con la mano en alto.
I had the height and youth advantage, but he had the experience. And as we spoke yesterday, I had to figure out what he was going to bring, had to adapt myself to that, and I would get the victory that way.
You're from Puerto Rico. What does it mean for you to have this victory at your home?
Eres de Puerto Rico. ¿Qué significa para ti tener la victoria aquí en casa?
Bueno, estoy contento, feliz. Soy el mejor 126. De Puerto Rico actualmente, Brian Chari Chevalier.
I'm very happy. I'm very content with my performance. I am the best 126 pounder in Puerto Rico right now, Brian Chari Chevalier.
You're only 26 years old. What's next for you?
Solamente tienes 26 años. ¿Qué sigue para ti?
Bueno, sí, se lo dejo a mi equipo de trabajo, Emilio Lozada, Ricardo Figueroa y a la compañía que han hecho un gran trabajo conmigo. Estoy sumamente contento. Y que venga lo que venga, ellos saben que yo peleo con todo el mundo.
I just have to keep working. I leave it up to my trainers and my managers to figure things out. I keep working. Whatever comes, I'll handle it.
Congratulations. Bob, back to you.
Thank you.
Congratulations to Brian. An impressive performance as he takes out the veteran Carlos Zambrano at 221 of round number three. And it was a left to the midsection that finished off Zambrano here in Puerto Rico. Our main event still to come, 154 pounds. What will Brandon Adams unveil next? He loves the superhero. Hopefully the costume comes off a little bit quicker this time. The main event coming up next on Ring City USA.
I'm a warrior. I'm a warrior. I'm a warrior. I'm a warrior.
And we are getting set for tonight's main event. Brandon Cannon Adams, 22-3 with 14 knockouts. Getting set for our main event. And the feature in our main event for the second time on Ring City USA. He'll be taking on Serhii Bohachuk. El Flaco from the Ukraine. Started boxing as a kid for self-defense, came from an impoverished background in the Ukraine, realized he could start making money in the sport. And is that a million-dollar smile? We're going to find out tonight as he steps up in class against Brandon Adams. These two were scheduled to fight back in December at the Wildcard Boxing Club in Los Angeles, but the main event could not happen because Bohachuk tested positive for COVID-19, but he says he's ready to go.
On November 25, I'm wake up, I'm feeling my head pain, very pain. Make a test, yes. I'm got it coronavirus.
Gee, he was really sick, unfortunately, and we had no other choice but to cancel the fight.
Finish training, I'm finished contact people, I'm go home. It is hard for me because I don't disappoint my family.
Я имел тяжелое детство. Всегда мечтал заниматься боксом. Я понимал, что это единственный путь вот пробиться, вот заработать денег. И всегда вот занимался и старался вот стать чемпионом.
One of our first conversations, at the time he was 17-0, 17 knockouts. And I said, so what? It doesn't matter your record. To be a world champion, you have to allow yourself to be coachable. And he understood that from the get-go. He's like, yeah, I understand, that's why I'm here.
I like it, everything, new combination, new position, everything teach me. Don't stop, never. Now I'm more stronger. Now I'm hungry. I wanna show my fans good boxing, hard boxing.
Serhii Bohachuk, not only is he 18-0 with 18 knockouts, but he also in his spare time likes to fish. He learned that Big Bear. He's trying to hook his biggest catch of his career tonight. Sean, let's take a look at the DNA for Serhii Bohachuk.
Yeah. You know what? The people in the boxing game, we call him a blue-collar fighter. He's got 18 fights, 18 KOs, but he doesn't really have one-punch knockout power. So how's he get those KOs? With a relentless and ruthless attack. He goes right at his guys. He stays on them all night until he gets the job done. What he's going to come in here tonight and do, he's going to clock in, and he's going to go to work on Brandon Adams. And just like the Terminator, it's going to be hard to stop him from going to work.
Well, we'll see what Bohachuk can do tonight against Brandon Adams. He's got his Scorpion's Mortal Kombat costume ready to go. Turned pro in March of 2011. He's got much more experience, 114 rounds under his belt. He's a man who is certainly for all seasons.
Welcome to the Brandon's Bunch. It's important for me to be home for my family because I didn't have a father growing up. I didn't have, my dad wasn't there. I want to break the cycle and, you know, I want them to be able to be independent, but also know that they always have this structure, this foundation right here. One of the biggest things that we all kind of into, the comic life really, it's about more so superheroes. This guy, you know, he wants to be Flash. That's his favorite. When you talk about DC, it's Flash. When you talk about Marvel, he loves Spider-Man. This little guy, he loves Spider-Man too. Bryce, he like it all. It doesn't matter, you know. If he could be Godzilla, that's who he wants to be. That's where he gets to walk in.
Your daddy, you're a superhero?
Yes.
I am.
Yeah, yep, you're a boxer.
Oh, I appreciate that.
But he likes to have a lot of fun, and he's going with the Scorpion Mortal Kombat look tonight. You approve, Sean?
Absolutely. SMF did a great job with that costume right there.
As long as he's able to take it off. Let's not forget when we saw him in December with the Bowser costume. Needed a few different people.
Sean, let's take a look at the DNA outside of the costume for Brandon Adams.
Well, hey, I mean, we have to start right there. Brandon Adams is an entertainer. He loves to entertain, and he is not gonna leave that fun personality in the locker room. But when it comes to him as a fighter, he's a loose cannon. He's all over the ring. He's very versatile, can do a whole lot offensively and defensively. He can go at, we should look at him to go at Serhii Bohachuk tonight, as well as put Serhii in some positions where he can do this right here. The explosive finish that we saw in December. In order for him to get the job done tonight, he's gonna have to use both those cannons and explode on Serhii Bohachuk.
You know, he's been a pro for 10 years. He said, my route made me a better person. I learned humility. I had to grow up. When I wanted things to go a certain way, they didn't. But I'm a better man for it. Tonight, he'll be taking on Serhii Bohachuk. 18-0 with 18 knockouts and a big step up in class for Bohachuk. The main event coming up next here on Ring City USA.
Serhii Bohachuk.
I won this fight. I'm hungry.
Versus Brandon Adams.
The pressure is just to win.
The fight we wanted in December, it's even a bigger fight tonight.
I'm my hard puncher.
It's time to tape them up, lace them up, and let your fists do the talking.
I don't plan on bringing anything short of greatness.
Brandon, keep your hand up. I will hit you hard.
Do I think I can knock him out? I know I can knock him out.
It's time for the main event on Ring City, USA.
From El Gimnasio, Félix Pagán Pintor, Guaynabo City. Boxing is back in Puerto Rico. This is Ring City USA. Anyone, anytime, anywhere. And the moment has come to find out quién es el más macho. Entering first, fighting out of the blue corner, Brandon Adams.
Brandon Adams. 8-1 with 8 knockouts in his last 9 fights near that 154-pound limit. Brian, you know, one of the interesting things he told us as he tries to project a certain image, not only to the public, but to his family, he didn't like the cards he was dealt in life, so he turned them back in for a better hand, and he's created that scenario for himself.
Look, this is one humble human being here, a guy who didn't come up the easy way in boxing, had some ups and downs, but really realized through that process not just how good he can be in the ring, but maybe what this calling is for. And he's really been focused on giving back to the sport, helping other fighters. And as you saw in the great feature with his family, being a role model, not just for those inside of his own house, for his community and beyond. He wants to sort of change the culture in boxing and really just preach love and friendship all the way around.
All
across the ring, in the red corner, Serhii Bohachuk.
Serhii Bohachuk, 25 years of age. Sean, he's never been past six rounds. He said it's not an issue. He's gotten in enough work. But he certainly is stepping up in class tonight.
Stepping up in class. I stepped up. My first 10-round fight, I never done 10. My first 12 round, never done 12. It's a part of the process, and he's about to go through it today. However, he's going through it against the toughest competitor that he's been in the ring with so far. Different type of energy, too, from what we had previously with Brandon.
Serhii Bohachuk, born in the Ukraine. Does have an infectious smile, though.
Yeah, for sure.
There's a real fun side to this guy. He may be called El Flaco, but his trainer, Manny Robles, says we call him Easy around the camp because anything they ask him to do, any challenges ahead of him, he says, yeah, easy, no problem.
Yeah, just like that.
Yeah, easy.
So set for our main event. Let's take a look at the tail of the tape for Brandon Adams and Serhii Bohachuk. Bohachuk, 25 years of age, and you see he's got the decided height advantage at 6 foot compared to Adams 5'9", but it's not something that will deter Adams. Bohachuk with the reach advantage as well. Now time for the formal introductions for our main event once again to the ring and Lupe Contreras.
We continue with the action here at El Gimnasio Félix Pagán Pintor, Guaynabo City, Puerto Rico, su alcalde, el honorable Ángel Pérez. This is Ring City USA, presented in association with Bash Boxing, 360 Promotions, Banner Promotions, and Tournament of Contenders. Our officials at ringside for the WBO, Edgardo Sasso Lopez. For the WBC, Saul Suarez. Our judges at ringside are Chris Flores, Steve Weisfeld, and Luis Ruiz. At the sound of the bell, the man in charge of the ring, referee Ramon Peña. And now, ladies and gentlemen, prepare to be entertained. This is the main event of the evening. 10 rounds on the line. The WBC Continental Americas and the vacant WBO NABO Super Welterweight titles. Presenting first, the fighter standing in the blue corner. He enters the ring, wearing red with silver and gold trim. He weighed in at an official 153 3/4 pounds. In 25 pro bouts, he maintains an outstanding record of 22 victories against only 3 losses, 14 of those victories coming by way of KO. The former world title challenger and season 5 contender champion, representing Watts, California, Brandon the Cannon Adams. Across the ring in the red corner, wearing white with gold trim, he weighed in at an identical 153 3/4 pounds. Tonight, atop the Ring City canvas, he looks to maintain his undefeated record consisting of 18 victories. All 18 victories coming by way of knockout. Defending his WBC Continental America Super Welterweight title from Los Angeles, California, and hailing from Vinnytsia, Ukraine, Serhii El Flaco Bohachuk.
Adams on her second. Okay, guys, both of you are professionals. You already received the instructions in your corner. Remember, protect yourself all the time and respect my commands. Trust yours. Okay? Let's go. Ready?
All right, here we go.
Ready?
The fight's so nice, we had to schedule it twice. I've been waiting for this one for a long time, fellas.
As have I.
It's gonna be good. Sean, what are you looking for early in this fight?
I want to see these guys do what they do.
That's it. I said this at the beginning of the fight. Brandon Adams has it on his trunks. SMF, styles make fights. Whoever can implement their style tonight is going to walk out of this ring victorious.
Take a close look at how fast Bohachuk starts. One thing that Adam said ahead of this was, you start fast against me, I'm going to make you pay.
Sean, I want to ask you this. Brandon Adams' trainer is the legendary Dub Huntley, who is 80 years of age because of COVID-19, didn't make the trip. He's got Chris Camacho as his lead trainer. Is that a factor tonight?
I'm not sure how much of a factor it is. I don't know Dub. How he works during a fight. I know that he has a supreme background.
Great, no punches.
But I got a feeling that Brandon brought the guys down here that he's comfortable with, that he feels can help him get the victory tonight. And early on, exactly what I expected, at least, Bohachuk to walk straight forward. That thumping right hand after the jab, right there on Brandon Adams.
Adams has been stopped once in his career. That came back in 2015 at the hands of John Thompson. Thompson was down in round one, and then he finished off Adams in round two.
And right now, Brandon is not operating with the type of fighting style that's required to beat Serhii Bohachuk. You have to move. You have to stick and move, twist and turn them like that right there, and then get back to work. The same thing. You have to be consistent with that, because Bohachuk is consistently going to come after you and stalk Brandon Adams.
Nice left hook off the break there from Adams. That's a very important punch in his arsenal.
And then to the body as well. The body shots, we all call it, but we all say the same thing. Make those deposits early and take it out later.
Well, Sean, you've had time sparring with Brandon Adams in the past. You know him well. You've called him a chameleon. I'm interested to see, as this fight develops, who he decides to be, because he surprised all of us December 3rd, taking Sonny Duverson out. He may not be known as an aggressive puncher, but he has that if you give him that opening.
Yeah, no, if you give him the opening, and I think that's what he was saying to us in the fighter meetings, that Serhii was going to walk into some shots. He's expecting Serhii to create openings for him because of his style. Right there, a great hook, but Serhii's got a chin. He can take those punches. That's probably the fourth or fifth hook now that's landed very clean for Brandon, but has very little effect on Serhii.
But Adams is the one landing the punches here in round one.
But guess what? This is not the pace that a lot of guys like to fight at. It's the pace that Serhii likes to fight at.
10 seconds.
Good left hook to the head, scored by Adams. And that is the end of round number one. We mentioned Brandon does not have his regular trainer, Dub Huntley, with us. He explained why.
One, two, go. One, two, three, four, fight.
It's a pandemic going on. Dub Huntley is, I'm saying, it depends on the day. Sometimes Dub is 30, 29 in the waist. Hey, but, you know, Dub's an 80-year-old man, and I don't want to, you know, put him out there to have to be flying from here to Puerto Rico. It's definitely gonna be different, but I've been groomed. You know, Dub has done a wonderful job at grooming me. So everything he's taught me, everything I've learned in the sport of boxing and in life just in general, I take with me.
I love that word he used. He said Dub's groomed me. And I do the same thing. When my dad's not in the gym with me, I'm taking myself through the same things that my dad would take me through. I know that he's got different guys in the ring right now, but he's still going through those same motions that Dub would take me through.
Round number two begins. Adams had a pretty good first round.
Bricks! This pressure's weak!
You see what I'm saying? Sometimes he's out, sometimes he's in. You know, it makes it hard for guys to pick up on where he's going to be. And, you know, that's kind of what I mean when I say a chameleon.
Adam's looking down at the canvas a lot, even during the ring introductions. Doesn't seem to be the right footing for what he wants to do out here.
I felt like Zabrano slipped in the ring, and I feel like the same thing's happening to Brandon. I don't think that he has the footing that he wants.
Left hand, short left hand by Adams got in there. Snap back the head of Bohachuk. Good left hook to the body by Adams.
Good work right now.
Bohachuk ends up inadvertently blurring a lot of opponents in because he's hittable, Sean. Mm-hmm. But the problem is if you linger too long in front of him, those shots begin to wear you down.
He's got a chin. He's a very durable and strong man. And he can lure you in, make you think that you're right there taking advantage. And just like right here, now he's taking some steps back and he's digging some uppercuts now, finding the openings. That's a smart fighter. That's a smart fighter. He knows that Brandon's underneath him, and he knows where to find him.
Good body shots by Adams.
And these are the moments that we were talking about where Brandon's got to find moments to let go of those cannons.
Break. No, well, Adam said, you know, certainly Bohachuk's got the reputation of a puncher, 18 wins, 18 knockouts, I'll tell you that. But Adams believes he's well more explosive and will show that to us as this fight progresses.
And of course, looks can be deceiving. So we see Al Flacco, and we don't expect the power that comes from him. However, we're right here ringside, and we can hear those punches when they land. Good work and good work rate right now by Brandon Adams. But this is where Serhii is comfortable. How comfortable is Brandon doing this right now? And is he going to be able to keep this up?
It's providing entertaining theater at the very least early on. They're fighting in a phone booth this round.
Yeah.
And it's not a big ring to say the least to start with. That one right on the belt line, the hook by Adams.
Time. Okay. It's not the first time, okay? Okay?
Okay, yes, sir.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
Are you all right? Okay.
Sir, yeah, it's easy. Let's go.
Okay, but the next time I'm gonna take a point, okay?
Okay.
Okay. Bucks!
This is what Serhii came here for. That physicality is no problem for him.
Part of the problem that Adams has is the belt line of Bohachuk is basically at his chest, being the shorter man. End of round number two. Take a look at that punch that was ruled on the belt line.
Welcome back to Ring City USA from Puerto Rico. Tonight's headliner, Serhii Bohachuk, has the word easy on his trunks. He says, easy life. Last December, it wasn't so easy. He went through what he calls the hardest experience of his life, and that is having coronavirus. He had to watch the fight from home when Brandon Adams fought the replacement opponent, Sonny Duverson. I asked Serhii what he thought about Brandon's performance. He said, I'm not impressed. That was not a tough opponent. And tonight, I am 120% ready. I'm double ready for this opportunity. Back to you guys.
Didn't he post a picture on his social media page of Super Mario spinning around Bowser? He's having a little fun. He's got a great personality. As we begin round number three, Steve Smoger has given the first two rounds to Brandon Adams. Hard to disagree with that. Yeah.
Good overhand right there, followed up by the body shot by Brandon, and kind of doing what he said to us in the fighter meet is a little bit of movement would open up Serhii for big shots. He's been able to land.
You know, the commitment to the body is obvious here from Adams. He's trying to invest for later in this fight, but he's also in the line of fire to do that. And this has been a close fight so far, however you have it.
I don't know if that was a stumble or a slip by Serhii, but what people didn't see in between rounds was Brandon Adams' brother complaining about the surface of the ring, saying that it's not suitable. It's not, they got to do a better job of cleaning it and getting it right. I think both guys are having problems with the footing.
Well, also, just feel the air. We're outdoors here in Puerto Rico, and you can feel the humidity setting in. I mean, the papers at our desk have moisture in it, so it's got to be gathering on the ring surface as well.
I got to ask, BC, is this the fight you expected?
I didn't expect Brandon Adams to be this committed to fighting at short range and seemingly right in the wheelhouse of what Serhii Bohachuk does best, which is let those hooks go, those uppercuts. So far, Adams taking it well and walking down the bigger man, but you have to wonder over time which one will start to wilt first from the pressure.
Yep. We are three rounds in now. We're approaching. And the pace is fast. The pace statistically and, you know, from what we have studied is in the advantage of Serhii. But he's beating him right now at his own game.
Yeah. Brandon wins on the inside, although that last punch was again on the belt line.
It looked like it.
That one looked lower than the one he got warned for.
Yeah. Yeah, but remember that the referees always have to be in position. We saw earlier the ref wasn't in position and called a knockdown that we didn't agree was a knockdown. Double up hook right there. I don't think Serhii's winning these rounds right here. See, they're both slipping. They're both slipping.
Time. 1 point. 1 point. 1 point. You okay?
So Adams losing a point here in round number three.
Don't do it again.
You know, in his corner, very outspoken in front of us. They don't like it. They feel like the low blows, they're coming from both ways. They felt those shots in particular were right on the belt line.
I haven't seen any low blows by Serhii. Both these guys are slipping.
That's the end of round number three. So let's take a look again at the low blow that cost Brandon Adams a point in round number three. That last right was the one that referee Ramon Pena stepped in and took the point away. All right, so who'd you give the round to? So if you give that round to Bohachuk, suddenly this fight's tied because it becomes a 10-8 round with it being a two-point round.
I have it a tie game at this point because of the point taken away.
One thing to note here, something you mentioned, Sean, is the footing is making both fighters look at times as if they're wearing these shots more than they are.
Come on, ref. Let's go, ref. Don't take it from us.
Yeah, the footing is becoming a problem. When you're a power puncher, as we see in Serhii, you got to plant the throw. You can't plant, and you're not getting the type of power that you want. And then same thing for Brandon Adams, a guy who likes to move, likes to use the ring, likes to, you know, be in and out. Now you don't have the footing to do what you want to do. I got a feeling that Brandon is uncomfortable, and I got a feeling that that's on his mind, and it's going to stop him from doing some things that he's been successful doing up until this point in the fight.
We saw Steve Smoger's scorecard, so the Hall of Fame referee was thinking along the same line as us. Bohachuk the round, and then the point deduction, and suddenly the scorecard is even.
The thing I see about Serhii, his right foot, clearly it slips. It comes out from behind him, but he picks it right back up and he keeps going forward. You can tell that he's not affected by the surface of this ring. Brandon dragging his feet right there. He's acknowledging what's wrong, and his mind is not on what I need to do to beat Serhii. It's on other things.
He's also starting to hang out at a distance a little bit further away than those early rounds. And while we questioned, is that a dangerous spot to be in, it's almost more dangerous to let Serhii step in with that right hand, which is his best punch.
I agree. I agree, but let's also remember that, you know, we say, or I say, that Brandon is a chameleon. There's gonna be, it's...
Come on, break!
The corner is yelling. it's good for Brandon to be, now he's on the outside where he, sir, he may have gotten used to that rhythm of fighting on the inside for the last two or three rounds.
Main event underway. Ring City USA kicking off the 2021 schedule. Three bouts in Puerto Rico over the course of this month. Serhii Bohachuk, 18-0 with 18 knockouts, squaring off against Brandon Adams at 154 pounds. No knockdown so far in the fight. Adams had a point deducted in round number three for a low blow.
Good hook right there by Brandon. Oh, guy slipping right there on that same side of the ring, too. Good hook right there by Brandon and then body shot.
Don't push. Break! Don't throw him break, okay?
Now back to the rhythm of being on the inside. You know, you mix it up like that, and it makes it hard for a guy to figure out where you're going to be.
It's also a check of the mental toughness of both of them, but particularly Adams, not only dealing with the loss of the point, which he's conflicted about, he's not able to sit down on his shots. He's ice skating left and right there over that logo in the center.
Yeah, and then look at Serhii. Serhii now bending his knees a little bit, bending at the waist, trying to develop, create some power on the shots.
End of round number four. They touch gloves, good sportsmanship at the end of the round.
A very good round as well.
Okay. You gotta pump that jab. That jab is there. Keep your distance with that jab, okay? Come on, work that jab now. Work that jab, please. Work that jab. That's all you need to do. Work that jab and set about that, okay? Get low with the jab, get high with the jab, all right? Get high with the jab, get low with the jab, brother. It's perfect. Breathe. Okay? Breathe. Breathe, my brother. Breathe. Win it. Everything's looking good.
Not only is it slippery, this referee is working against me, bro.
You have to have an experienced
corner. Let's focus.
Mopping up the ring. A lot of humidity in the air, plus the sweat from the fighters, the water coming off the trunks.
I heard Brandon's corner tell him at the end, right there at the end there, to focus. But the corner's not focused. Look at that, they're sliding. Sir, he's smart. He says, let me bend down a little bit. Let me bend my knees and get this power so I can get this guy out of here.
Dame el mapa de nuevo. Dame el mapa. Pedí tiempo para secar. Okay?
Referee Ramon Pena take matters into his own hands and clean up some of the water from the corner of Brandon Adams.
Neither guy has had complete control of this fight or anything like that, but there still is a energy of momentum. And for Brandon, you're not necessarily surviving, but you're fighting a fight that you got to fight to win. And now this break here, you know.
And you add on the frustration that we talked about. Definitely from the moment that point was taken, you felt the momentum shift go over to Bohachuk.
Yeah.
See if he can keep it going.
Yeah.
Round number five begins. Hall of Famer Steve Smoger has Bohachuk up by a point.
Break! Break!
They're yelling for the saying that Sir, he's using his forearms to create distance.
Break!
And he is, and it's, I guess it's technically, it's not legal technically, but it happens a lot in boxing. You know, you have to create that space.
I've seen a few Sean Porter fights where it's happened. That's all I'm saying.
Is that why I'm massaging it right here? You know, Floyd's known for that too. So Floyd's known for the shoulder roll, but he also cocks that forearm up so that he can keep guys off of him.
Break!
He's driving the elbow down!
Look at the elbow, okay?
Come on!
Why haven't you took a point, bro?
Is the quarter of Adams being more concerned right now about the referee than what's happening in the ring?
They're more concerned about the ref, and they're more concerned about one thing that's happening in this fight. There's so much more that needs to happen and is happening than a forearm to your chest or to your face, your head right there. It happens. You got to be physical and roll with the punches and do what you got to do to win.
And is that where maybe Dub Huntley not being here, the veteran trainer, to snap things back to focus of, we got to figure out what we're doing strategically here to try to win this fight, not worrying about the referee deducting a point from Bohachuk to even things up.
It's very possible. Go ahead, BC.
No, I was going to say, you need that voice of reason who can tell everyone in your corner sometimes, pipe down, let's focus on what matters at the moment.
Exactly. It's like I say, you have to have an experienced corner. An experienced corner knows how to get to the ref and tell them exactly what's going on so that they can look out for it. But yelling at the ref, refs don't like to be yelled at. So the more you yell at him, the more he's going to ignore you. Just how it goes.
Switches to southpaw momentarily, does Adams.
Yeah, they said they brought in
Fernando Vargas Jr.
Jr. because he likes to switch. But I don't know Brandon to be a switch hitter like that enough for you to, you know, spar specifically for a southpaw.
I'm curious to see how Steve Smoger has this round scored, because each guy has had some moments.
Good hooks on the inside from Bohachuk.
Did Bohachuk win that round in the final 30 seconds?
That's hard to say.
That was a tough round to score.
Remember.
Make sure you join us after our coverage for Ring City USA's Inside the Ropes on Twitch, right after our main event from Puerto Rico.
Hey, you've been amazing. Work that jab a little bit, okay? Try to keep him in distance, all right? I know it's hard. Work the jab, protect yourself on the hooks and uppercuts. All right, he's not throwing straight punches. Uppercuts and hooks. That's what he's doing, and he's weak to the right. He's shuffling to the right, okay? So let's try to put together and come off to the side, all right? Breathe for me.
Good breath. Yeah, agarra tu cubeta. Agarra tu cubeta. Okay.
This is who Bohachuk is as a fighter. He's going to come forward, he's going to throw punches, and he's not going to stop. He's going to stalk, and he's just going to throw punches.
But
it's Brandon's job to figure out when I fight his fight and when I fight my fight. Brandon fighting his fight, moving like he is right now, lines him up for trouble, because he's at the end of the long jab like that right there, and he's at the end of the punches. So he's got to figure out, hey, how do I fight this guy's fight and then get him out of what he does well at the same time?
Well, first of all, he's going to have to find the right footing to fight the kind of fight you thought that he was going to come out there and do in the first round, which is move.
And I don't want to downplay it. It's clearly a factor. But for a guy in Serhii who is just going to move forward, he's not going to change directions, stepping's not that much of a problem for him the way it is for Brandon Adams, who's going to go left and right, forward and back.
And you saw Steve Smoger gave that last round to Bohachuk. He did the best work in the final 30 seconds of that round in what was a pretty close round.
Hey, what's up, Double S? I gave Bohachuk the last round, too.
I like it better when you guys fight, all right?
They didn't bring him in. They haven't brought him in. For Brandon, the fight's got to be about timing at this point. Like that right there. Time him coming in. Either tie up or move off the ropes. You know? You
have to look at it from a judge's perspective, though. While Adams is landing a clean counter shot here and there, is he active enough, considering how well Bohachuk's cutting off the ring and really dictating the terms here?
And my thing if I was judging, I'm so glad I'm not an official judge. My thing is, what are you trying to do and are you able to do it? I see Brandon wanting to move and then he's in and he's out. When he's moving, is he moving effectively? Is it working for him? At this point, he's not able to get far enough away from Serhii that he doesn't get baited back into a fight. And then on the inside, I'm not sure he's doing enough on the inside. I didn't give him the last round. Right now, I do have him winning with the round. But then you go back to the outside like that right there, and you're at the end of the shot.
Right hand over the top, and then a hook to the body by Bohachuk.
Hammer. Everybody that I spoke to, they said Bohachuk can punch. Looks can be deceiving, but you hear it.
With that said, in the reputation and the numbers, 18-0, 18 KOs, you do like what Manny Robles, his trainer, just the second fight they are together. He said when he came in, he didn't want to talk about the knockout streak. I don't want to plan for that. I'm not training you to knock people out. I'm training you to win fights.
And he just said that 2 rounds ago. He said, hey, so what if we don't get the knockout? Keep working. You got to keep working. Just keep working. They understand what Serhii can do, and they want him to do it.
So we are through 6 rounds. We got a big day of A-10 basketball for you. The quarterfinals tomorrow. Duquesne taking on St. Bonaventure in that first one. We got Dayton and VCU at 3:30. George Mason and Davidson come your way at 5:30. Quarterfinal action, A-10 basketball right here on NBCSN. Ring City, USA from Puerto Rico, the first of 3 dates here in Puerto Rico. And Serhii Bohachuk will head into the 7th round for the first time in his career. We take a look at some of the action from round 6.
The chopping overhand right there. That is his bread and butter. And then look at him, just walking Brandon Adams down. It's not glamorous. It's not crazy eye-catching. When you understand the sport, you understand what he's trying to do, and you have respect for it, you say, man, this dude can work.
Time!
And they're expecting to take him into the deep waters and something to change. I'm telling you guys right now, I don't expect anything to change for Bohachuk except for him to get stronger. And nobody expected that in the Brandon Adams camp.
Well, Sean, we asked the 5th member of our broadcast team, the Hall of Fame referee himself, Steve Smoger, what would he do as a ref with Adams' team complaining so outwardly about the forearms from Serhii? And what he said is nothing. Let them fight unwarranted complaints. So if you're in Adams' corner and you hear that, it's got to be focusing on the fight.
There you go. You focus on the fight, and I'm telling you, experienced corners, they know how to get the attention of the ref in the manner that it will make the ref become aware of what they have a problem with.
You see the last 4 rounds, according to Steve Smoger, have gone to Bohachuk, including that 3rd round, which was pivotal because Adams had gotten off to a good start, and Adams lost a point for a low blow.
Yeah, that was a good round for Brandon that he was winning. Like BC said, there was definitely a shift at that point in the fight.
Even in the last round, you know, through the first 2 minutes of the last round, you could make a case that it was anybody's round, but it was the meaningful punches, the crisp punches, the more powerful punches landed by Bohachuk in that last minute of what was a relatively close round that you have to kind of give it to Serhii.
Not to be critical here, we haven't seen Adams go to the body in a while, and that was a calling card in the opening rounds when he seemed to really set a good tone.
What do you got to do to get to the body, though, BC? You got to get close. And when you get close, you get roughed up. You get the elbow to the face. You don't like that, so you stay on the outside like what he's doing now.
Let's check in with Curran, who paid a visit to the corner of Bohachuk.
Spoke to Manny Robles, who's of course training Serhii Bohachuk. Says he's not worried about the slickness in the ring. Said they faced this in their last fight against Davila. And if you remember, Bohachuk actually took some punishment early in that fight with some rain in Mexico. Overall, he hears the other corner yelling about elbows. He says that's because Brandon's coming in with his head down. Manny's happy with Bohachuk's pace, but he wants him to go to the body more. Back to you guys.
And I like Manny. We spoke to him in the fighter meeting, and I wanted to get it clear. He has an Olympian on this Olympic team. I had to tell him that. He says, well, he hasn't qualified yet. No, Brent Manny, you've got an Olympian. And he was a part of the 2012 Olympic team as well as a coach. Has done a lot of international competition with with the Olympic program, and he's got a lot of professional champions and former world champions.
Of course, was in the corner of Andy Ruiz, one of the greatest upsets in heavyweight history against Anthony Joshua.
Yeah. So the questions I was asking Manny, I just wanted to make it clear, like, this guy's got experience, and given the opportunity, he'll show it. And he's showing it through Serhii Bohachuk right now.
Adams with some decent defense there to get away from those shots. He does land a hook to the body, but he gets countered right back.
See, this is what Serhii does to everybody. You can't get far enough away, especially not in this ring. And then even if you get far enough away, you breathe for 2 seconds, maybe, and then he's right back on you. It's tough.
10 seconds.
It's not an easy style though, to beat. You gotta have power, you gotta have a lot of skills, and you have to have a lot of different things that you're gonna throw at a guy like Serhii Bohachuk.
7 rounds in the book, scheduled for 10.
Be careful all the time, be careful with overhand. That's all he has right now. That's all he has. He's looking for one shot.
Well, we're celebrating boxing here in Puerto Rico. Make sure on Sunday you celebrate Hockey Day in America on NBC and NBCSN. 4 great matchups, 1 epic day. It all begins with the Sabres Islanders at noon Eastern on NBC. Ooh. We're going to be back here in Puerto Rico. That's where our next bout will be in 2 weeks, 2 weeks from tonight.
All right.
3 trips to Puerto Rico in the month of March for Ring City USA.
Young, come on, baby. Come on. Come on.
Right there, he's just trying to get Brandon Adams to stay tuned. Stay focused.
Box.
And Manny, Robles and Serhii over there. Just keep working. Keep doing what you're doing. It wasn't working early. I'm going to say that. It was not working early because Brandon had his number early. He knew exactly what he wanted to do. But Serhii is blue collar. He's going to wear you down. He's going to clock in and go to work. He's not going to complain. Not going to look for ways out or anything like that. He's going to do exactly what he's doing right now. Keep stalking. Keep walking.
Well, you got to give him a reason to stop stalking. And then that's something that hasn't happened in a while for Brandon Adams. And you wonder, Sean, it's round 8 of 10 here. Mm-hmm. Are we getting into that territory where we need some drama out of Adams to make sure he's in this fight?
Absolutely. We need some drama from Adams because I think, if anything, he's shown weakness to the judges with his movement. You know, a lot of judges, when you're moving and a guy is fighting and coming at you, judges honor that. And then I think the other thing too, with the complaining, he's shown that, you know, he's not all about the fight game. You know, and with a guy like Serhii, you got to be willing to fight and fight and fight. And I can keep saying fight until the fight's over. That's how long you got to be willing to fight.
Good left hand to the chest there by Bohachuk. Adams has never scored a knockout past the 7th round. And with the way this fight is going, at least on Steve Smoger's scorecard and mine as well, he's going to need one to win.
And let me say this, because I'm not against a guy who can box and can move. I love it, and it's a part of my game. But when you're boxing, you're moving, but you're still getting hit. You have to be flawless in these moments where you're on your toes and moving. You got to be flawless. The guy can't touch you. He can't get close to you because that gives the influence to the judges that he's doing what he wants to do and he's winning.
Yeah, so there was movement, but within that movement by Adams, he got tagged a bunch of times.
Dumping.
Bohachuk's so good at cutting off this ring. A staple of, let's say, champions like the great Gennady Golovkin of Kazakhstan, just knowing how to control you, corner you. And let's talk about this. Bohachuk hadn't been past 6.
Counter left hand there by Adams.
Good hook. He's going for it.
There he comes.
He's going for it.
Oh!
Left hand drop Bohachuk.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
And it's going to be stopped.
Wow. Yeah, that got me up out of my seat. Whoa.
dare I say, a left hook from hell. That was a thing of beauty in there.
He is so light on his feet right now and working and working and working. He was on his way, so he was. That we said it. We said that Brandon. So okay, so let's do this while we have a moment. We said that Brandon needed some drama to pull out the fight. Not only did he get the drama, everything that we saw in the last fight in terms of his energy, his charisma, his ability to break down his fighter and take him out. He did it again. And now we've seen it twice, so we can say he's consistent at what he does in terms of beating fighters at what they do well and what they don't do well.
Bob, that dramatic enough for you, Bob?
Pretty impressive, because it was going the wrong way for Brandon Adams, and he records the latest stoppage of his career.
Watch this, hook.
That got Bohachuk wobbly, and then watch this left hand
and
coming
the cannons.
Up.
We're gonna get it slow. Sir, he was still there. He knew what to do, but his hand was down. Right hand down. You have to know hooks are coming right there. You're a tall man, but at that point, he should have tried to get down.
It may be Thursday night, but that's a Sunday punch right there. That's the one.
I have no clue what you're talking about. Can I Google that? Can I Google a Sunday punch?
At this point, Bohachuk was hurt, and the left hand just connects right on the chin.
That was crushing.
And at least on our scorecards, Brandon Adams was down and needed to land that cannon to win the fight. Don't know what the judges had it. Our own Steve Smoger had Bohachuk up by four.
I think I'm adding it up. I think I had it tie game at that point in the fight.
So Brandon Adams improves to 23-3 and records his 15th stoppage.
Oh no, I actually have Brandon losing by one round.
Serhii Bohachuk loses for the first time in his career. For the official time of the stoppage, here's Lupe Contreras.
Ladies and gentlemen, this bout comes to a sudden and dramatic end as referee Ramon Peña is forced to call a halt to the action with an official time of 2 minutes 47 seconds of round number 8, declaring the winner by way of technical knockout. And now the new WBC Continental Americas and NABO Super Welterweight Champion from Watts, LA, Brandon the Cannon Adams.
Brandon Adams was down on all three judges' scorecards and down big. He needed that knockout, and he got it.
I didn't have him down big. I'll say this real quick, BC. I didn't have him down big. I had him down actually just by one round.
Well, I'll tell you what the judges had it.
I
69, 63, 68, 64, 68, 64.
Yeah,
I had it 68, 64. Steve Smoger had it 68, 64. But it doesn't matter when you land a perfect left hand.
When you go through things in the ring, this is what fighters who have experience. When we say we've been through things in the ring, this is what we mean. It takes adversity to make a champion. And Brandon was up against some adversity.
Yeah, how about the medal? I mean, they take away a point. Yeah. He's upset about the forearms, he's upset about the footing, yeah, and the mental capacity to focus in and get the walk-off home run. All right,
good. We'll take one more look at it. And at this point, Bohachuk was hurt. And his hands were down, and a perfect left hand by Adams finishes off Bohachuk, who is no longer undefeated. He was 18-0 with 18 knockouts coming in, but he gets knocked out. Brandon Adams unloads the cannon. We'll hear from a victorious Brandon Adams when we return to Puerto Rico on Ring City, USA.
un cabrón.
Aquí viene que va a pelear rico, ¿no?
¿Quién está aquí?
Yes. I can do that in the third question. Copy that. I'm gonna ask you two questions, and then the third one we're gonna look at highlights.
Okay.
As soon as we're done here in Puerto Rico on NBCSN, switch over to Twitch. Ring City USA's Inside the Ropes. We will have highlights and more reaction from tonight's card in Puerto Rico. Brandon Adams with a stunning eighth round stoppage of Serhii Bohachuk down on all three judges' cards. And big, he's with Curran.
Here with the winner, Brandon Adams. So Brandon, of course, coming into this fight, the storyline was your longtime trainer, Dub Huntley, couldn't make the trip. I'm sure he's watching at home. What do you think he's thinking right now?
First and foremost, man, I would like to give the most high of praise and shout out to Cannon Nation by calling out these five people, if you don't mind, real quick. Baby Tyson, James Brock, Tatsuro Irie from Japan, Josh Juarez from Texas, Kyrie Everest from Buffalo, and Alima Cajota, Condi, from Santa Fe Springs. But I hope I made Dub proud. It was real tough fighting in there tonight, the ring being wet. The referee, you know what I'm saying, he wasn't for me tonight, so I had to fight against an uphill mountain, if you will.
It wasn't necessarily trending in your direction, right? The slick ring, you lost a point for a low blow in round three, but you were able to find the knockout win. What did you find in there to get that stoppage?
Man, I just had to dig in deep and understand that regardless of whatever was happening during that fight, it was me against them. And I had to embody that and use all the strength that I had to connect one of those punches from the cannon.
And so we're going to take a look at your performance here against Serhii Bohachuk. We're going to look at some highlights and have you talk us through them. This was a very anticipated matchup since last December. So what do you see here?
Me trying to move and slip, man, but the from the ring, it was just real hard to move. It was hard to gather myself. I'm an explosive fighter, so I tried to take advantage of that, and I couldn't tonight because I didn't have my legs under me. But the minute that I was able to land a few punches, man, I just had to do what I had to do. He smiled, too. He was a tough guy, man, and I appreciate the fight. He brought another side of me that, you know, I knew was in me, but the people got to see it today.
On an emotional level, you had Chris Camacho in your corner there, stepping up to be head trainer. You had your brother, Terrell Adams. between rounds, they were unhappy with the refereeing. They were unhappy with the ring. It didn't seem to be the best. It seemed to be a little bit of a somber attitude in the corner. How did you guys turn it around?
Man, we just got faith in the Most High. We got faith in the Most High. Even though I was real irritated with what was happening, I still had to go. The show must go on. So, I'm a professional. I got to figure out how to get the W. That's what matters. That's what counts.
And you've had success now at 154 pounds. What do you think is going to be the next test for Brandon Adams?
I'm going to go back with my team and figure it out. Right now, and I just want to go home and be back a dad again and bring the kids home this trophy. I'm grateful for the win, man. Like I said, I appreciate every last one of everybody who was here. I love Puerto Rico. Everybody out here embraced me with love. And this was what it takes to be a world champion and not just a champion in our backyard, the United States. I know Puerto Rico is a part of the United States, but I'm just saying this is how we start to move and then we start to go to country. I'm grateful.
Finally, last time out, you came out as Bowser, this time Scorpion. I know that you
finish him.
You were able to get the finish. You lived up to the Scorpion name. Brandon, congratulations.
God bless everybody here, man. I appreciate everybody for coming out, showing some love and some respect. And I'm going to keep doing what I got to do to keep getting them W's. Thank you guys so much. Erica, congratulations on winning. What happened? Oh, yeah, I read all five of them. Congratulations on graduating today. That's my wife, you know what I'm saying? She graduated. Shout out to my baby girl. And I love everybody.
Congratulations. Bob, back to you.
Brandon Adams giving his shout outs. Congratulations to his wife for graduating, but he was down on all three judges' scorecards big, and in round number 8, he hurt Serhii Bohachuk with the combination at this point. Bohachuk is feeling the pain. The hands come down and a perfect left hand on the chin finishes it at 247 of round 8.
You know, we had to wait a little bit longer for this fight, but boy, did it deliver.
It did.
This is really what hashtag anyone, anytime, anywhere is all about, a 50-50 fight in so many ways. Bohachuk got out to a great lead, but Adams had the last say.
And here's a look at what we were able to see tonight here in Puerto Rico. And obviously a frustrating end for Danielito Zorrilla as he wins a technical decision against Ruslan Madiev. I was impressed by Madiev, despite the fact that he wound up losing the fight.
Yeah, I was impressed by Madiev. A lot like Bohachuk, a fighter who likes to come straight in and be aggressive. His aggressive attack was working and breaking down Zorrilla. But he got greedy quite a few times, and it cost him.
And we'll have an update on Danielito Zorrilla in our Inside the Ropes coming up on Twitch. And then Brian Chevalier, well, pretty impressive what he was able to do in finishing off Carlos Zambrano in round number 3.
And I'm ready to talk about this on Twitch. I'm ready for this. That was a great fight. Brian Chevalier, he's up and coming. He's next.
And we're back here in Puerto Rico in 2 weeks, the main event, 10-round lightweight bout as former 130-pound champion Alberto Machado takes on Hector Tananjara. And Brian, looking forward to that one for sure.
Yeah, high pace, high stakes, big opportunity for both guys. You have to know that these guys are going to step on the gas and give us the kind of fun fights we saw tonight.
And Jose Martinez and Israel Gonzalez in our co-feature as well. Well, it was an explosive night here in Puerto Rico. Lots of twists and turns along the way. But in the end, Brian Adams getting business done. Make sure you join us on Twitch for Inside the Ropes as we bring you the complete post-game. We'll have highlights. We'll have more interviews. You don't want to miss it. For our entire crew, Bob Papa saying so long from Puerto Rico. You've been watching Ring City USA on NBCSN.